The question has been asked time and time again. Where are we now? This world as we know it started some 6,000 years ago, when in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1, God created the heaven and the earth. Further on in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 27, God created man and woman. They sinned by Genesis chapter 3 and verse 6. This caused separation between God and man. However, by in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15, a promise was given to them, a promise that one day they will be restored to their Creator again. Since then, we have seen a people scattered in the desert. We have seen God's people enslaved for hundreds of years. We have seen kingdoms rise and kingdom fall. But is this the final kingdom? Where are we now? Where are we in this earth's history? Where are we in the promise of restoration? The Bible says in Luke chapter 21 and verse 28, "And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh." Is our redemption really near? Or will it ever come? Will we be waiting for a couple thousand more years? Where are we now?
Where are we now? You know, that's a question that has been asked many a times, and we're here to answer as best as possible, just outlining just a few events. Now, you know, Ecclesiastes chapter 1 verse 9, a text that I like to look on things concerning this matter. "The thing that hath been, it is which shall be, and that which is done is that which shall be done. There is no new thing under the sun." Now, if you journey with me to Genesis chapter 3 and verse 4, we saw a dilemma, as Eve found herself speaking to the serpent. You know, the serpent said in verse 4 that, "Ye shall not surely die, for God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil." Now, one of the things Satan always does and continues to do is to try to use what we call education in order to allow people to fall. Now, what are you saying? Now, what the devil presented to Eve is that she will begin to have increased knowledge, and that is what education really is, or educating, it's increasing your knowledge. So therefore, Satan will use the very same ploy in this time and age to try and deceive many. Now, if you journey with me across the waters to Europe, you see where it says, an article from the Vatican News, it says that global compact on education bears in itself a seed of hope. Now that sounds wonderful, it sounds good, because education is something that should be aspired after. Now, a global education pact was set in place to commence sometime in this year. I think it should have been October, but because of the pandemic, it switched around things, right? It should have been in May initially, but it switched around things. And so the Pope is calling back for this education pact, and it sounds good. So the aim of this is to bring everyone together. And it says that the initiative promotes the values of care for others, peace, justice, goodness, beauty, acceptance, and fraternity in order to build hope, solidarity, and harmony everywhere. Now that sounds very good, but with us as Christians, we have to be able to look beyond some of what the devil disguises. So first thing that he's being called upon here is for human fraternity and a common goal, what we call solidarity. So it speaks of a coming together. But if you know, Christ says in Isaiah that, "Say ye not a confederacy, say ye not a confederacy." When Christ says we're going to join with each other, we're going to join in with individuals who go contrary to his will, we'll be broken together, or broken in pieces. So, you know, he's calling for this fraternity, but let us look a little bit deeper into it. He speaks of the pandemic now that is happening now. It pointing to the fact that there are a lot of inequality as it relates to education, and that we're seeing where some children are online and some children are not online. So some persons are not learning as others. But he speaks of the pandemic and how this education pact can also, what we call, put aside or help to deteriorate what we call the throwaway culture. Now, what is that and how does that fall in? Now, the throwaway culture is what we call consumerism. And that is individuals who have high amounts of money buying what they probably don't need while some are suffering. Now, if you look back at 1888, one of the things that caused the first Sunday law to almost be passed was that there was high consumerism in America. So therefore, they're saying that we must pass a Sunday law to combat consumerism. And we're seeing it coming out, the same theme of consumerism. Another thing is that, as I said earlier, that he's saying that the COVID crisis is bringing out the fact that there's inequity in education. And I remember saying some months ago that what the devil does, he uses what we call the Hegelian dialectic, creates the problem, then offers a solution. So the problem became the pandemic. What took place after that? You have children are learning, some are not learning because they lack resources to go online. And now this education pact should be something now to heal that problem. So as we all come together, we put aside differences and we try to sort this out. Now again, this seems very good. But the thing is, what does Satan have behind it? At the end, the end goal of all of this is getting everyone together on common grounds, and that was mentioned there, and that is what we call the common good. Whereas those who are different from the larger sect, should be put out of society. And that's leading down to one thing: to God and His people. When we stand apart from everyone else, then we'll be looked upon as the ones causing problems upon the land. And the next thing, a death decree will be passed. So it was then, so it shall be now. As they said of Christ, it is better, it is more expedient that one should die than the whole nation perish. So when we see these events calling people to come together, we know that surely God is soon to come.